This evening, we close our spring season with Hanan Ashrawi, a name synonymous with the struggle of Palestinian rights. The world became familiar with Dr. Ashrawi during her term as the official spokesperson for the Palestinian delegation to the Middle East peace process. It was her face we saw on television, her voice explaining the Palestinian side of the conflicts to journalists worldwide. Dr. Ashrawi lives in Ramallah, Palestine, where she lives today with her husband and two daughters. She received both her bachelor's and master's degree from the American University of Beirut and her PhD from the University of Virginia in Charlottesville. She established and chaired the Department of English at Beirut University and also served as Dean of the Faculty of Arts. She is now heading up the Palestinian Independent Commission for Citizens' Rights, an organization she founded in 1994, monitoring human rights abuses. Dr. Ashrawi comes to the Ford Hall Forum tonight to share a personal view of the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. Her recently published book, This Side of Peace, A Personal Account, sheds new light on the behind-the-scenes events, including meetings with the former U.S. Secretary of State James Baker when the Middle East peace process was launched, and the several rounds of talks with the Clinton administration. This book is available for sale tonight in the back corner of the hall, and Dr. Ashrawi will be signing copies of her book after the program this evening. Ladies and gentlemen, it is with my pleasure to welcome Dr. Hanan Ashrawi.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It is indeed a pleasure and a privilege to be here tonight, and I really thank you for this very warm welcome. I'm deeply touched, and I thank you also for hosting me in this beautiful city of yours and in this particularly significant historical building. After all, I think that the subject of tonight's talk is going to touch very intimately, I think, to bear on the issue of historical validation and vindication. And being here is quite relevant in this building. Thank you very much. And now, having heard my academic credentials, I promise you I'm going to try to resist the temptation to lecture, which is endemic to all academics, of course. And I felt that tonight should be much more of an intimate exchange of ideas. And I will use, in a sense, the book as a vehicle to introduce the subject of tonight's discussion, the same way as I took the liberty of using the first-person narrative, the personal account, as a way of introducing the collective reality of the Palestinian people and introducing the peace process as a whole. To me, history is really, as I said in the introduction and the foreword, that history is a collection of individual narratives, and that the validation of the collective historical narrative comes through the vehicle of the personal experience. And I wrote this book in a way as an act of commitment, an act of love, and in the book I called it an act of amana. In Arabic there is a word called amana, it is not the appliance in the US. And I said only a word so modest and simple could have the magnitude of meanings and suggestions as the word amana, which is a sense of trust, of commitment, of loyalty, of discharging a duty, and of bearing a trust and a gift. And since the whole peace process was to me the beginning of a process of amana and of trust, for the historical validation of the Palestinian people, this book was a modest contribution. So I wrote it using my story, because from my little corner of that experience as a modest player, I felt that it is my duty, first of all, to respond to those friends and colleagues of mine who worked very hard for very long to change the course of history, who dared to intrude and to intervene and to validate again the voice for peace and the discourse for peace. Many of them remain unknown, although I did try to present them in the book. And they asked me, they said, if you don't write, nobody else will write, and therefore our little chapter in history will be lost. Or somebody else will write about us from the outside, and as usual, we will be distorted or misrepresented. So again, as an act of love and a manner to those people, whether in the political committee or in the negotiations delegation, the larger team, I wrote their little chapter in history very modestly. And again, the whole purpose of a role of spokesperson, I've always said, was to capture and convey and present the reality of the people, the human substance and reality, and not just to present political slogans or positions. And so even as spokesperson, I have always told the truth, even if it didn't please many people. I didn't try to manipulate the facts. I didn't try to be propagandistic. And I've always carried with me this deep commitment to the human dimension of the process. Because to me, if you lose sight of the human substance of all endeavor, and after all, I've always said, the end of any, or the objective of any political endeavor should always be the well-being of the human being. If you lose sight of that reality, if you lose touch with that substance, and if you lose touch with the moral base and a sense of values that you have, then again you lose the integrity of your utterance. And so also I felt as spokesperson, but not in the official sense, in the human sense, I wanted to relay in immediate terms the reality, the human reality of the Palestinian people, who have often been maligned, who have often been subject to stereotyping and labeling or a convenient dismissal. And it seems to me this is a very appropriate time to discuss labels and stereotypes and reinventing or redefining the enemy. So again, that was another motivation in writing the book. And when I said this side of peace, I meant that side which goes beyond the spectacle and the fanfare and the signing and all the visible celebrations of a formalistic peace process, a side that is very little known because it is the side of the people who are acting from within. It is also the human side. It is the side of the people who are on the receiving end of peace rather than on the formal or visible end. And again, it is the side that probably tells more of the truth about the reality behind the ritual than about the fact of the signing itself. And in this peace process, frankly speaking, we entered this peace process as an act of will, as an act of commitment, as an attempt at intrusion in history, to intervene, to change the nature of the discourse, to find a platform in order to present the Palestinian narrative in an honest and immediate way. And we said in the Madrid speech, we had to address both the heart and the mind together with an honesty and an urgency that had to be understood and grasped. We had to find a place for our people as a people among equals, as a nation among nations. And we had to end this practice of the confiscation of our voice and our will as Palestinians. We no longer were willing to be the absent Palestinians or the maligned or distorted Palestinians. We wanted to be there in the international arena. And if there were forces shaping our future, we wanted to be part of that shaping. And as we said in the speech that I had not given, remember when I went to the PNC, it's in the book, the Palestine National Council, which is our parliament in exile. It was illegal then to have any connections with the PLO, and the PNC also was considered illegal, so we had to go on the secret night journey to address the PNC. And I gave a speech there, which the newspapers described as the speech that I would have given had I been there. because we didn't want to give the then Likud government the opportunity to imprison us. Not that they didn't try, they tried, but it didn't work. There was no evidence. So in that speech, I used three key terms. I said, it is time that we intervene, it is time that we challenge, and it is time that we participate in the decision making. And we did. So it takes much greater strength and determination to change this course of history from inevitable conflict to possible reconciliation, to find a constituency, an audience, and credibility for the language of reconciliation and peace rather than for the language of perpetual conflict and struggle. And that, and believe me, it takes much more courage to undertake a peace process than it is to continue to allow the situation to deteriorate into perpetual conflict. That kind of courage, I think, was exhibited by many Palestinians and many Israelis who decided that they had to intervene, take the decision to change this course of history. Unfortunately, the peace process did not go according to plan. Not that it started out being perfect, it was flawed because it did incorporate the asymmetry of power, it did incorporate Israeli preferences, priorities, and preconditions. But we sought to transform it into a vehicle for change, to transform reality, that this process itself would be an agent of change. Since the whole issue of agency, of course, is important, and the role of the individual in intervening in the course of history is important, and it goes throughout the book, we felt that we can transform the process in order to use the process in order to transform realities and create new conditions that would generate new realities. And we based it on the basic and simple principles of parity, mutuality, reciprocity, and of course, firmly based within a sense of justice. It may be a cliche, but I think that any peacemaking effort without the substance of justice and the principle of justice is not going to achieve any genuine peace or genuine stability and cannot claim any permanence. The peace process, unfortunately, ended up gradually diminishing, and I called it a process of diminution. Right now, we are witnessing what I call a grand deception. People feel that because there was a signing, because there was all this spectacle and fanfare on the White House lawn, that the Palestinian question is solved, that the Palestinian-Israeli conflict has been resolved, that the occupation has ended. And I hope you will permit me to taint the image with a bit of reality. This is not the case. What's happening is that we have embarked on probably the most difficult period of our history. The signing of the Declaration of Principles on the White House lawn I described as a landmine. I said this is the beginning of a process that could lead either to statehood or to disaster. And it depends on what we do with it. And I'm afraid there is a global reality, not just a Palestinian-Israeli reality, which is a crisis in leadership. There's a lack of vision. There is a lack of courage. There is a lack of wisdom to deal with the imperatives of peace and to intervene in the course of history again at the leadership level and to imbue the political process with a sense of morality and values. And I know that in these jaded and cynical times, it is not very fashionable or popular to talk about moral values and moral politics. Everybody is used to the politics of power and politics of manipulation and electioneering as being the basis of decision making and so on, and self-interest as being the main motivation. But I think, again, it is time for us to intervene and to say that without that element, without that component of moral politics and the human dimension, then the peace process is in danger of losing its core. And once, of course, the center collapses, then you cannot have a comprehensive vision of peace in the region. So now we have a severely flawed process. a process that attempted to postpone the serious issues, the crucial issues, issues of the land, issues of particularly the settlements, and the continued expansion of Israeli settlements, to postpone the issue of Jerusalem as a central issue, not just as a celestial city, but as a terrestrial city, the issue of refugees, and of course the issue of human rights. That was entirely excluded, of course, and became a bargaining chip in negotiations. These were postponed without any assurances or guarantees that their outcome will not be predetermined unilaterally by one side. And what is happening now, particularly now as the issue of Jerusalem is a very hot issue, considering the confiscation of land, the building of new settlements, the very, very painful American veto in the Security Council, and of course the continued Israeli moves at legitimizing and consolidating the illegal annexation of Jerusalem. So while these issues were postponed, one side was exploiting the time and its power as occupier to impose facts, to create facts that would prejudge the issue and that would render negotiations irrelevant on these issues. Not only that, but I'm afraid that the Palestinian leadership in many ways has exhibited a lack of will in the peace process. And I said the process brought us back full circle to face ourselves. This process has unleashed many internal issues and conflicts, including issues of internal human rights, including the real challenge of nation building, of institution building, to go through a transitional phase whereby we would lay the foundations of a future Palestinian state that would be based, firmly based, on the rule of law, on democratic principles that are translatable into implementable mechanisms of inclusive democracy, of accountability, of respect for pluralism, of genuine representation, all within very severe constraints. Now, this nation-building process is undergoing severe difficulties and problems, given the fact that there is a peace process that is floundering, that there is no sovereignty or genuine control over the land, that the process has adopted the functional rather than the territorial approach, the fact that Israel can at any time close their territories and therefore cause tremendous hardship, whether economic deprivation or what we call the pressure cooker effect in Gaza and Jericho, since they control the crossing points. And the classical dilemma of the Palestinian Authority is, to whom should it deliver? What is the source of its legitimacy? The Israelis and Americans think that the Palestinian Authority should deliver in accordance with an agreement which is flawed, as I said, with no implementation mechanisms, with no detailed presentation of the issues. And in delivering to the Israelis, the security of the Israelis, the Palestinian Authority is pitted directly against its own people, because it has to violate the basic rights and freedoms of its own people. In many ways, the process and the co-sponsors, let's say the Americans and Israelis, are trying to redefine our enemies. They're telling us that Hamas and Jihad Islami are our enemies. And I'm saying they're not our enemies. They are part of the Palestinian political fabric. They have the right to express their political disagreements in peaceful and political ways. And therefore, it is up to us to create the democratic mechanisms for inclusiveness, for debate, for political participation, and for the expression of these differences. Our enemy is a global enemy. Our enemy continues to be poverty, ignorance, lack of political will, repression, violation of the rule of law. The occupation continues to be the enemy. And the legitimization of military domination as opposed to peaceful resolution. These are enemies. But to have others define for us our enemies, I think would be a process of self-destruction. The most dangerous thing for the peace process would be if it becomes a process of self-negation and a process of the delegitimization of the voices on both sides that took tremendous risks in order to launch this process and keep it alive. And ironically, both leaderships that were viewed as the leaderships for peace, as the voices of peace, are now being undermined because of this diminution of the process itself, of its being bogged down in technicalities, of its becoming a reactive process that, rather than a process of vision, of its becoming bogged down in a cycle of violence and counter-violence, and with its lack of mechanisms whereby reality will be transformed, and its lack of internal sustained motivation to create an incremental process. So right now, I think the peace process requires a process of rectification, requires what I call a process of intervention again, an act of will, to say these are the central issues, this is where the process went wrong, this is the act of courage that is needed in order to redress these issues, to address them and redress them, and in order to again make the process a vehicle and a force for positive transformation and change. And that requires the basic ingredient of legitimization, mutual legitimization, rather than the asymmetry of power. It requires the process of genuine recognition, not technical recognition. It requires the politics of inclusion, and it requires the vision and the wisdom and the courage which I feel has been lacking, have been lacking in the process itself. I also want to conclude with a very brief statement of hope, because I, in diagnosing and detailing the problems and the issues which we can talk about in the discussion, I don't want to leave you with the idea that it is hopeless or that there are no alternatives. The worst thing would be for anybody to adopt the mentality that there is no alternative, and therefore you have to accept whatever is happening. No, there are alternatives, and the alternative is a comprehensive, inclusive, courageous, substantive process that would lead to peace. Peace is the option. Peace is the choice because we chose it. But in negating or undermining this, the validity of this process itself, I don't want the concept of peace to be negated and undermined. And I think this act of intrusion is very important. I have confidence in the will of the people, the people who have not succumbed to intimidation, to exclusion, to attempts at even the eradication of their national identity as Palestinians. And I have also confidence in the agency of the individual will when it decides to intrude on history and to make a difference. And I'm sure we will make a difference. And I'll be glad to take your questions. Thank you.
Well, as Dr. Ashrawi said, she is now willing to take your questions. This is really, as I had mentioned before, a regular part of the forum's programming. We will encourage anyone in the audience who has questions to come to the microphone in the front of this center aisle. I would ask only that you speak very clearly, as this program is being taped for broadcast on WBUR Radio and BNN-TV, courtesy of Clean Harbors. I'd also ask that you keep your questions succinct so that as many questions as possible can be answered. Yes, sir, please.
Two succinct questions. One, do you fear for your own life in the situation you're in? And two, I heard you on NPR criticizing the closing of the borders, and I'd like you to amplify why the Israelis should not close the borders if they feel physically threatened by those coming across the border.
I'll stay and answer.
Okay, I can answer from here. I hope you don't mind if I answer sitting down. Would it be too rude? No. Okay. All right, as far as fearing for my life is concerned, I'm sure there is a risk, and I know there is a risk, and I've received threats, and I've seen my name on many hit lists before, and I've actually faced machine guns several times, but somehow I was miraculously saved, I don't know why. But I don't allow that to become a fear, because fear paralyzes you, and if you decide that you want to be safe, then you certainly don't take risks. And that you certainly do not dare to intervene and take positions and speak out honestly. And I've noticed that in our part of the world there is greater and greater reticence. And there is a silence which is extremely ominous, and I don't like it. So I will continue to speak out, and I will continue to present my views, and I will continue to work in order to redress the injustice that I see taking place. And I don't think there can be any risk greater than the risk of being born a Palestinian. Because the moment you're born a Palestinian, you have... I have always said you're born with a risk and a responsibility. And you can never escape those two. You might decide to step outside history, but it will not allow you to step outside it, because you are immediately being called upon to vindicate the fact of your Palestinianhood or Palestinianism. So I might as well take risks in the cause of peace and of moral politics and of justice rather than die as an unwilling, unwitting victim, passively being one of the Palestinians who didn't dare stand up and speak. As far as the closure is concerned, yes, I think the closure as it is being practiced is a form of collective punishment. Because Gaza and Jericho are being transformed into collective prisons. They cannot function as isolated, discrete entities. They are not. They have to have interaction with the rest of the Palestinian territories, and they also have to have interaction with the Arab world. Now, if Israel wants to entirely disengage and close borders with the Palestinians, that is fine, provided our borders are open with the Arab world, so that we can have free access to Jordan and free access to Egypt. But to close us off entirely would create a pressure cooker effect, would create feelings and conditions of tremendous hardship, particularly of economic deprivation and hardship, and that would be a sure recipe for further violence.
Yes, sir.
I wanted to congratulate you on breaking a taboo in your book, which I read with great interest. The taboo connects to your opening about the importance of human rights and moral ethical values. To say the obvious, human rights and values are not divisible. You cannot say they're only special rights for Palestinians or Israelis or Americans or blacks or whites. No. And the taboo I am talking about, maybe I'll read, if I may, very briefly a paragraph from your book, because this illustrates the question. May I?
Well, we'd prefer you to just ask your question.
Okay, let me ask the question. The taboo is described very strongly in a book you must be familiar with, Canon Machia, Cruelty and Silence, in which, according to this very courageous Iraqi Arab writer, Arab intellectuals do not ever criticize anything done by Arabs. Now, in your book, you describe the murders of women and wrongly accused, and of men, of collaborating with Israelis. But if you limit the rights to just rights of Palestinians, and don't enlarge even just to the rights of women in the Arab and Islamic world, there are millions of women every year, 100 million together, who are being sexually mutilated. There were 20 to 40,000 people murdered in Halabja.
Your question, sir?
The question is, could you say from your strong position about the right of women, not just in Palestine, but in the Arab and Islamic worlds, and what can you do about it?
Yeah. Well, as you said, human rights is not divisible, democracy is not selective, and self-determination applies to everybody. At the personal level, the human level, the gender level, as well as at the national level. Now, this book is a personal narrative that attempts to present a Palestinian narrative. And from the beginning, it didn't claim to be comprehensive and inclusive of everything. It's not an encyclopedia of the Palestinian or the Arab experience. And therefore, the principles of selectivity and order, although they are literary, they had to apply. And I had to structure it in a way that would be coherent and would have a theme that would be pursued, and at the same time that would be honest with the key events and the key perspectives. I think I addressed the issue of human rights violations by Palestinians very openly, very vocally. I have also addressed the issue of Arab leadership very vocally and very openly. I have addressed the issue of the excesses, even of the Intifada, of the killing of collaborators, and condemned it and showed scenes from it, people who came to my home. And I have also talked about the Israeli victims, in all honesty, like the girls in Khadera who were killed because they happened to be in the wrong place at the wrong time. I think human life is equal, and I think citizens, I think innocent civilians cannot be used as victims in a political struggle. And when it comes to the issue of women, and that's regardless of nationality, as you said, when it comes to women, I mean, if I want to write a book about women's rights, it certainly will be more than one volume. This is an issue that has been an ongoing, not just theme, but I call it an obsession in my life. Not as an individual, not as Hanan, but also as part of the collective women's movement, the Palestinian women's movement, that has dared and defied so much, and that is working now very actively, not just to formulate a Palestinian gender agenda, but also to reach out and to be part of a comprehensive women's movement globally, internationally, and to place Palestinian women at the forefront, or at least among the rest of the sisters in the world. Now, this takes tremendous courage, and there are many women who are working, who have taken risks, who have defied traditional patterns and norms of discrimination and repression, and who are not recognized. And I hope that I will be able to, if I may, use whatever platform I have in order to present their cause. I don't believe in the individual woman being the token or the symbol at all. That can be used as an excuse for the exclusion of other women. I believe that there should be a collective, strong women's movement that would form the source of strength for any individual woman, and a support system and a system of protection. And at the same time, any individual accomplishments have to be brought back to bear on the collective women's movement. We have spoken out against many practices. Sexual mutilation is not practiced in Palestine at all. We don't have that practice. We don't even know it. So that's not our main issue, even though in some African countries it is practiced. What we deal with are issues that pertain to discriminatory practices and habits, to attempts at excluding women from positions of decision-making and authority, at imposing restrictions. We deal with the authentically Palestinian issues while placing them within a larger, of course, theoretical framework and gender agenda, but at least we deal with the issues that are immediately of relevance to the Palestinian women. And we don't take upon ourselves every single issue all the time of all women everywhere, because heaven knows we have enough. I mean, when we launched the campaign to get women back into the judiciary, when people attempted to exclude them from the judiciary, in one night we got the judges and the women prosecutors reinstated, because all the women mobilized and said, that's it, this is a confrontation and you won't get away with it, and we got immediate results. We are trying to review the legal system to ensure there is no discrimination. We are setting up support systems. We are also creating institutions that would have power, that would have teeth to intervene. On the one hand, in affirmative action and intensive training programs to get women into places where they should be. On the other hand, to monitor the activities of the government, of the PNA, and to ensure that women are where they belong, at the forefront, next to the man, and neither behind the man nor in the kitchen. I think that should be enough for now.
Please.
Dr. Ashrawi, how do you think, what do you think is the best response
for the Palestinian National Authority to take in regards to the current crisis with the land acquisitions in Jerusalem specifically, and with the continued settlement problem in the territories generally?
Okay, well, we have a national committee for confronting the settlements. And this national committee contains everybody in it, the whole political spectrum, plus intellectuals, the political elite, the leaderships, and, the independents, the local leaderships, and so on. We all agree there is a consensus that you cannot reconcile the peace process with the settlement process, because settlements and land confiscations negate the substance, the validity, the basis, and the objectives of the peace process. This peace process is based on the formula land for peace. And if the land is being taken over by Israel, that totally negates the possibility of peace in the future. And so I believe that this is one of the most serious and most dangerous aspects of this land confiscation, particularly now the issue of Jerusalem. Jerusalem is on the agenda for permanent status negotiations. Israel does not have the right to unilaterally preempt and prejudge the issue and to create facts in Jerusalem that are, of course, prejudicial to Palestinian rights. Settlements are, as a whole, are preventing the possibility of the emergence of a Palestinian state with any kind of geographical contiguity or coherence. And settlements are the most visible and concrete expression of an injustice which would totally negate the peace process. The American position on the issue of Jerusalem, to me, is a very dangerous position. I described it today as people who rush in where angels fear to tread. Jerusalem is an issue that should not be meddled in by the Americans for electioneering purposes or any other purpose. And I think very seriously that this American veto in the Security Council has disqualified the US from the peace process as an even-handed peace broker or as a co-sponsor, because it has violated international law, it has violated its own policy, and it has violated all the imperatives and all the principles and all the objectives of the peace process.
Would the eventual Palestinian state that you would like to see come about, in your desire, be a duplicate of the State of Israel, or would it have some characteristic or characteristics that would be fundamentally different?
Well, I don't think there is any state in the world that's a duplicate of any other state. We don't want to be a duplicate of the Arab countries, and we don't want to be a duplicate of Israel, and we don't want to be a duplicate of third world countries, and we don't want to be a duplicate of the US. There is such a thing as authenticity and cultural continuity and historical continuity. There are certain principles in common that we would like to have, that should be universal, that are not exclusive to any country or any nation state. We want to have a democratic state, and we want to have a state for all its peoples, one that respects the very rich fabric of the Palestinian experience and Palestinian society, one that respects political and religious pluralism, and one that would be based, as I said, on the rule of law, and on, of course, a just legal system and contemporary legal system, and one that would empower its own people and its own civil society rather than create a centralized military system. One that would safeguard the rights and the freedoms of its citizens, and one that would allow the individual to flourish, to grow economically, intellectually, politically, in every possible way. So in a sense, I think these are values that are universal. However, the cultural, social, historical fabric of our society and of our nation would dictate that we be true to our own identity. And we cannot be a duplicate or a carbon copy of anybody else. But from this authenticity, we have to emerge with a contemporary and global vision of these rights and these freedoms that we have to protect. I hope that answers your question. Thank you.
Yes.
Well, first of all, I'd like to say how incredibly honored I am to be speaking with you. I heard you this morning on the radio and tried to get through. However, we ran out of time. In reading your book, I was struck by the active role that women played in the Intifada that I was unaware of, and also the relative absence from the current leadership positions as they stand today. I would like to know if you'd like to comment any further on the role of women in the Palestinian society. I realize that was already asked earlier. And also the role of a Christian woman in a predominantly Muslim world.
Okay, well, in talking about Palestinian pluralism, I mean, being a Christian to me is neither a sign of distinction nor a sign of exclusion. It's a sign of inclusion and, again, a sign of authenticity. And I think I said on the radio today that to us, being Christians does not mean that we are different or that we are a minority. On the contrary, we can lay claim to a historical continuity. And I keep reminding people that Christianity did start in our part of the world, so it's not surprising that we are Christians. So in many ways, I mean, I have never felt that Christians, or that there are distinctions in Palestinian society depending on whether you're a Christian or a Muslim or Jewish, for that matter, because we have had this pluralism ongoing, and there are many people, even Israelis, who think of themselves as Jewish Palestinians. It's their prerogative, they're free to think that, and certainly our society should be open to have all religions. And again, I quote a friend of mine who said that God never intended Palestine to be monolithic, otherwise he wouldn't have created three religions in one place. So being a Christian to me is just a sign of belonging and commitment. It's just that the West is surprised because of the stereotypes that, you know, they assume all Arabs are Muslims. And again, the converse fallacy that all Muslims are Arabs. Now, there are many Muslims who are not Arabs. They can be Iranians, Afghanis, Pakistanis, Bangladeshis, whatever you want. And there are many Arabs who are not Muslims, who are Christians and who are Jews. So that kind of reality takes the world by surprise sometimes. And in breaking a stereotype, you get more attention, I guess, because people are, you know, sort of sit back and say, we've existed for centuries, and you shouldn't be surprised. As far as women are concerned, I did try to answer that question, but the Intifada, just to be very succinct on the Intifada, did not emerge out of nowhere, out of a vacuum. There was an ongoing women's movement in Palestine, and it started in the early 20th century. And I described it, I think, on the radio as being first a movement of middle-class urban women that had charitable organizations and so on, dating back to the 1920s. But Palestinian women have always had access to education. Our society has always been more open and liberal, particularly with the emphasis on education. And with every historical crisis, you see a resurgence of women's activities, whether in 1948 or in 1967, when the women were at the forefront of resistance to the occupation. Many of them even participated in the revolution. But we also learned from the experiences of the Algerian women and Western women after the Second World War, where they took crucial positions, and then when the immediate threat was eased or removed, they went back to the kitchen. You're right. So we are trying to, first of all, consolidate women's gains. We are trying to create support systems. We are trying to create mechanisms and networkings to support women's rights. And we are evolving this gender agenda that is Palestinian in many ways, but global and universal in other ways. And that is a source of empowerment for the women. The Intifada gave us, I described it as a period of an intensification and acceleration, because we had to take initiatives and we had to move ahead quickly. And in doing that, of course, there was some sort of backlash afterwards where people tried to push us aside. And I said at one point that the men now are using the conventional excuse. You see, all along they said, we have a national struggle. And the national struggle takes priority and is an urgent and immediate struggle, while social issues and gender issues have to be secondary, not primary, and can be postponed. So it took everything we had from the 70s to transform this attitude and to say, no, you cannot fight against oppression and discrimination at the national level and practice it internally. This is part of the comprehensive. And we also said that self-determination is something that women understand at the personal, individual level, as well as at the collective level, because we have to fight for self-determination individually every day in order to take over the decision-making capability over our own lives. And so if you are fighting for self-determination nationally, you have to fight for it and uphold it internally, especially with the women. And with the Intifada, as I said, we developed the women's committees that had started in the 70s. We evolved a new agenda and approach. And at the same time, we had to deal with the new challenges of this transitional phase, whereby the men are telling us this is a very delicate and ticklish and sensitive phase. So the women, you know, don't bother us with issues that might weaken us internally. And again, we have to confront this argument, and I said this today, and I will say it again. I said, it's the men who got us in this mess. Maybe it's the women who have to get us out of it.
Yes, sir, please.
Do you see any comparison with your struggle and the struggle in Northern Ireland?
Well, there are always comparisons, I mean, points of convergence and points of difference. I see also certain areas of misconception where people present both struggles as religious struggles when they are not religious struggles, whether in Ireland or in Palestine. And I think the struggle for self-determination is universal. And I think both were perceived to be, I mean, I don't want to go into the details because we all know them, but both were perceived to be the most intractable conflicts and struggles. And I think both now are witnessing at least the beginning of the impulse towards peace. And I think it is important because I think there is no conflict that is not soluble, that cannot be resolved, provided there is a will and the courage to do so. And I think all sides, whether the Irish or the English, or whether the Palestinians and the Israelis, I think have been, some of them have reached this conclusion on their own, others have been forced to reach this conclusion, that there can be no military solution to either conflict.
I think we have time for only three more questions. So
three?
If we could,
I was going to say one, but
please, Dr. Ashrawi, you mentioned the closure that's causing economic strangulation in the Gaza Strip in Jericho. Could you please describe something about the closure of Jerusalem, because that's received very little attention over here. I think people will be surprised to hear how severe it is. Yes. So if you could talk about the impact of that, thank you.
Yes. Well, the closure, or what we call the siege of Jerusalem, has become an ongoing policy, and it began with the peace process. Actually, it began before with the Gulf War, but then it continued with the peace process. Jerusalem, in a sense, is isolated. Palestinians from the West Bank cannot go to Jerusalem. You need a permit, and to get a permit, you have to go and stand for days before the military governor, and they'll have to inspect your credentials and make sure that you can go to Jerusalem, or you can go, or you have immediate business there. Now, the problem with the issue of, and there are, of course, checkpoints at every entrance to Jerusalem, whether to the south or to the north, whether from Ramallah or from Bethlehem. And that has created a situation of severe hardship. Because first of all, Jerusalem is a cultural center for Palestinians. It's an economic center for Palestinians. It is a health center. This is where our major hospitals are. And it is where the most economic transactions take place. But most importantly, there are families who live in Jerusalem and Ramallah, or Jerusalem and Bethlehem, or Jerusalem and other. These families cannot even see each other these days, because it's very difficult to get a permit. So they are separated because East Jerusalem, which is Palestinian, is being cut off from the rest of the Palestinian land. And I said we've become like a body, in a sense, without a soul. Jerusalem has always represented the Palestinian soul. Now, in the peace process, we got this letter of assurances, a letter from the foreign minister of Israel, Shimon Peres, talking about Palestinian institutions, saying that there will not be prejudice, that their work will continue, and so on. And on the contrary, they are serving a purpose, a constructive purpose, and they should be supported. And then we see the Israeli Knesset and the Israeli cabinet legislating against institutions in Jerusalem. So now there is a total strangulation of East Jerusalem. Most of the time it's like a ghost town because it survived by interacting with the suburbs, with people around it. I mean, even the people who used to sell vegetables in the streets, I mean, part of the whole life of Jerusalem has gone. And the economic activity has come to a standstill. There are, as I said, human hardships, separated families. The hospitals are no longer able to serve the rest of the Palestinians. We don't have, as you know, a hospital in each town and each city. We don't have a university or schools in each town and each city. Most people tended to go to Jerusalem and get medical treatment there. And that now is prevented. So even doctors and nurses who work in Jerusalem can't get there. Schools in Jerusalem are being deprived of West Bank students and West Bank teachers. So it's like creating this artificial rift. It's like, you know, severing a limb, you know, saying Jerusalem is no longer yours, you cannot live there. And personally, now it used to take 15 to 20 minutes to go from Ramallah to Jerusalem. Now with the checkposts and the bottlenecks and the searches and the permits, if you can get there, it's going to take you at least an hour to get to Jerusalem with no guarantees. And any Palestinian who is caught in Jerusalem without a permit is fined. And the fine starts at $100, $150 and goes up. So it's not just punishing Jerusalem and the Palestinian Jerusalemites. And even in elections, they are trying to exclude Palestinian Jerusalemites from elections, saying we can participate by voting, but we cannot run. Somehow it's like we're being again severed from the rest of the Palestinians. But it's also the whole Palestinian nation that is being punished by this isolation and siege of Jerusalem, because that continues to be the center of our existence and the definition of our self-value and the center of all our activities, not just geographically, but in every other way. So if there's anything that can be done, it must be done to save Jerusalem, because it's gradually being emptied out of its Palestinian people. It is impossible, next to impossible, to get a permit to build in Jerusalem. Palestinian lands are being confiscated constantly. And you see a reverse process. You see, on the one hand, an emptying out of Palestinians and a bringing in of Israeli settlers and a confiscation of Arab land to build subsidized housing for the Israelis in and around Jerusalem. And that has created a demographic and an institutional and a political and a geographic imbalance in the city.
Sir.
Hi, my name is Masoud Derhelli. I just would like to take this opportunity to say that since I first saw you on Nightline a couple of years ago, you've always been a source of inspiration, and you always will be. And my question to you goes along these lines. I'm a Palestinian of the diaspora. My grandfather is from Jerusalem. My grandmother is from Ramallah. When do we have our right of return, and when will we have our moment in the sun? Thanks.
That is a very painful question, because I know that unless the issue of the Palestinian exiles and the Palestinian refugees is solved, the Palestinian question will never be solved. There will always be a Palestinian question so long as the right of return is not implemented. There are two types of experience in Palestinian life. One is occupation and the other is exile, dispossession and dispersion. Both have to be solved if there is going to be a solution to the Palestinian issue, and it's not just a question. We have the legal basis. The right of return is enshrined in international law and UN resolutions. Resolution 194 continues to be valid. It is the basis of any just solution to the Palestinian cause, and I don't believe any Palestinian individual, group, leadership, or negotiating committee or delegation has the right to compromise or give up the right of return. So any solution to the Palestinian question has to be based on the right of return and has to make sure that there is an equitable solution to the two components of Palestinian experience and contemporary realities. The fact is that the exiles or the refugees as an issue have been postponed till permanent status talks. And even when in the agreement in Oslo it was said that the displaced Palestinians of 1967 will be returned, but that there will be a quadrilateral meeting to discuss the modalities of their return, this has not happened. The meeting took place between the Palestinians, Egyptians, the Jordanians, and the Israelis, and the Israelis said that they are not discussing the right of return or the return of Palestinians, and that it's going to take a long time before any Palestinian comes back. And that, to me, is another source that weakens the process, because any process that keeps within it this injustice is not going to be able to respond to the rights and the needs of the Palestinian people. And since that continues to be the cause of instability and conflict, it has to be the key to stability and peace. I hope that answers your question.
I'm Hilda Silverman, and I found that last question so painful, I'm not sure I can speak. I think there should be a parallel book to yours, and I haven't read yours yet, but I plan to very soon, called The Other Side of Victory. I don't know who should write it, but I think the Palestinian exile is one piece of that. And I think many questions have been about Jerusalem, and I've been deeply concerned about Jerusalem. And with Jerusalem, what I think of when I think of the other side of victory in a symbolic sense is the destruction of the Mughrabi quarter after Israel retook the wall in 1967, and things that were of enormous joy and continue to provide enormous joy for us Jews, obviously have caused enormous pain to Palestinians, and I feel that both have to be incorporated in both peoples for us to be able to go forward. My specific question is about Jerusalem 3000, which is going to be a 16-month celebration, going to be very much here as well as in Israel, and whether you can give us any guidance, since you are speaking so many places in this country, about how to handle those quote, celebrations in ways that will affirm the needs, the wishes, the desires, and the pains of both peoples.
No, that's, well, I can feel your pain and your concern, and it's very touching, but the issue of Jerusalem 3000, again, is a source of tremendous pain for Palestinians, because that is being used as a way of legitimizing and forcing a total Israeli possession of the city of Jerusalem, and of course forcing from the rest of the world a recognition of that expropriation of Jerusalem and exclusive possession. I think if we are going to have a celebration for Jerusalem, it should be non-exclusive. It should be a celebration for Jerusalem as a whole, for the Palestinians, for the Israelis, for all religions, if it embodies the principle of sharing and the principle of peace. But if it continues to be a city under occupation, a city severely divided, a city where one part of the population is totally disenfranchised and is oppressed and lives under occupation, then I don't think you have a whole city, and I don't think there is any reason to celebrate. And I think Jerusalem 3000 is again creating another myth, and that myth is bound to backfire.
We're finished. We're going to just take the opposite.
Okay. Thank you.